Dear friends, how are you all? I hope you are all doing good as per your own situation. So let's start today. We are going to start a new story, a new folktale of Bengal, and these stories are accumulated by Reverend Lal Bihari De in this book, which is known as Folktales of Bengal. It is a very old book. The first edition of this book was published in the year 1883, and this particular book was published in the year 1912. So let's dig in. Which story today we are going to read? Let's see. Yesterday we have finished the Ghosh Brahman, right? So today we are going for the next story, the man who wished to be perfect. So let's proceed to the story. The man who wished to be perfect. Once on a time, a religious mendicant came to a king who had no issue and said to him, "As you are anxious to have a son, I can give to the queen a drug by swallowing which she will give birth to twin sons. But I will give the medicine on this condition that of those twins you will give one to me and keep the other yourself." The king thought the condition somewhat hard, but as he was anxious to have a son to bear his name and inherit his wealth and kingdom, he at last agreed to the terms. Accordingly, the queen swallowed the drug and in due time gave birth to two sons. The twin brothers became 1 year old, 2 years old, 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, and still the mendicant did not appear to claim his share. The king and queen therefore thought that the mendicant who was old was dead and dismissed all fears from their minds. But the mendicant was not dead, but living. He was counting the years carefully. The young prince were put under tutors and made rapid progress in learning as well as in the arts of riding and shooting with the bow. And as they were uncommonly handsome, they were admired by all the people. When the prince were 16 years old, the mendicant made his appearance at the place at the palace gate and demanded the fulfillment of the king's promise. The hearts of the king and of the queen were dried up within them. They had thought that the mendicant was no more in the land of the living, but what was their surprise when they saw him standing at the gate in flesh and blood and demanding one of the young princes for himself. The king and queen were plunged into a sea of grief. There was nothing for it, however, but to part with one of the princes, for the mendicant might by his scars turn into ashes not only both of the princes but also the king, queen, palace and the whole of the kingdom to boot. But which one was to be given away? The one was a dear as the other. A fearful struggle arose in the hearts of the king and queen. As for the young princess, each of them said, "I will go, I will go." The younger one said to the elder, "You are older, if only by a few minutes. You are the pride of my father. You remain at home. I will go with the mendicant." The elder said to the younger, "You are younger than I am. You are the joy of my mother. You remain at home. I will go with the mendicant." After a great deal of yea and nay, after a great deal of mourning and lamentation, after the queen had wetted her clothes with her tears, The elder prince was let go with the mendicant. But before the prince left his father's roof, he planted with his own hands a tree in the courtyard of the palace and said to his parents and brother, "This tree is my life. When you see the tree green and fresh, then know that it is well with me. When you see the tree fade in some parts, then know that I am in all ill case. And when you see the whole tree fade, then know that I am dead and gone." Then kissing and embracing the king and queen and his brother, he followed the mendicant. As the mendicant and the prince were wending their way towards the forest, they saw some dog's whelps on the roadside. One of the whelps said to its dam, "Mother, I wish to go with that handsome young man who must be a prince." The dam said, "Go." And the prince gladly took the puppy as his companion. They had not gone far when upon a tree on the roadside they saw a hawk and its young ones. One of the young ones said to its dam, "Mother, I wish to go with that handsome young man who must be the son of a king." The hawk said, "Go." And the prince gladly took the young hawk as his companion. So the mendicant, the prince with the puppy and the young hawk went on their journey. At last they went into the depth of the forest, far away from the houses of men, where they stopped before a hut thatched with leaves. That was the mendicant's cell. The mendicant said to the prince, "You are to live in this hut with me. Your chief work will be to cull flowers from the forest for my devotions." See, this is our mendicant. And this is his small hut. And this is our elder prince who has culled the flowers for the puja or the worship of the mendicant. So let's proceed. This is a nice picture, right? Okay. So let's proceed. Okay. You can go on every side except the north. If you go towards the north, evil will betide you. You can eat whatever fruit or root you like, and for your drink you will get it from the brook. The prince disliked neither the place nor his work. At dawn he used to cull flowers in the forest and give them to the mendicant. After which the mendicant went away somewhere the whole day and did not return till sundown. So the prince had the whole day to himself. He used to walk about in the forest with his two companions, the puppy and the young hawk. He used to shoot arrows at the deer, of which there was a great number, and thus made the best of his time. One day, as he pierced a stag with an arrow, the wounded stag ran towards the north. And the prince, not thinking of the mendicant's behest, followed the stag, which entered into a fine-looking house that stood close by. The prince entered, but instead of finding the deer, he saw a young woman of matchless beauty sitting near the door with a dice table set before her. The prince was rooted to the spot while he admired the heaven-born beauty of the lady. "Come in, stranger," said the lady. "Chance has brought you here, but don't go away without having with me a game of dice." The prince gladly agreed to the proposal. As it was a game of risk, they agreed that if the prince lost the game, he would give his young hawk to the lady, and that if the lady lost it, she should give to the prince a young hawk, just like that of the prince. The lady won the game. She therefore took the prince's young hawk and kept it in a hole covered with a plank. The prince offered to play a second time, and the lady agreeing to it. They fell to it again, on the condition that if the lady won the game, she should take the prince's puppy, and if she lost it, she would give to the prince a puppy just like that of the prince. The lady won again, and stowed away the puppy in another hole with a plank upon it. The prince offered to play a third time, and the wager was that if the prince lost the game, he should give himself up to the lady to be done to by her anything she pleased, and that if he won, the lady should give him a young man exactly like himself. The lady won the game a third time. She therefore caught hold of the prince and put him in a hole covered over with a plank. Now the beautiful lady was not a woman at all. She was a Rakshasi who lived upon human flesh, and her mouth watered at the sight of the tender body of the young prince. But as she had had her food that day, she reserved the prince for the meal of the following day. Meantime, there was great weeping in the house of the prince's father. His brother used every day to look at the tree planted in the courtyard by his own hand. Hitherto, he had found the leaves of a living green color, but suddenly he found some leaves fading. He gave the alarm to the king and queen and told them how the leaves were fading. They concluded that the life of the elder prince must be in great danger. The younger prince therefore resolved to go to the help of his brother. But before going, he planted a tree in the courtyard of the palace similar to the one his brother had planted, and which was to be the index of the manner of his life. He chose the swiftest steed in the king's stables and galloped towards the forest. In the way he saw a dog with a puppy, and the puppy, thinking that the rider was the same that had taken away his fellow cub, for the two princes were exactly like each other, said, "As you have taken away my brother, take me also with you." The younger prince, understanding that his brother had taken away a puppy, he took up the cub as a companion. Further on, a young hawk, which was perched on a tree on the roadside, said to the prince, "You have taken away my brother, take me also, I beseech you." On which the younger prince readily took it up. With these companions, he went into the heart of the forest, where he saw a hut which he supposed to be the mendicant's, but neither the mendicant nor his brother was there. Not knowing what to do or where to go, he dismounted from his horse, allowed it to graze, while he himself sat inside the house. At sunset, the mendicant returned to his hut, and seeing the younger prince, said, "I am glad to see you. I told your brother never to go towards the north, for evil in that case would betide him. But it seems that, disobeying my orders, he has gone to the north and has fallen into the toils of a Rakshasi who lives there. There is no hope of rescuing him. Perhaps he has already been devoured." The younger prince forthwith went towards the north, where he saw a stag which he pierced with an arrow. The stag ran into a house which stood by, and the younger prince followed it. He was not a little astonished when, instead of seeing a stag, he saw a woman of exquisite beauty. He immediately concluded from what he had heard from the mendicant that the pretended woman was none other than the Rakshasi in whose power his brother was. The lady asked him to play a game of dice with her. He complied with the request, and on the same conditions on which the elder prince had played. the younger prince owned, on which the lady produced the young hawk from the hole and gave it to the prince. The joy of the two hawks on meeting each other was great. The lady and the prince played a second time, and the prince won again. The lady therefore brought to the prince the young puppy lying in the hole. They played a third time, and the prince won a third time. The lady demurred to producing a young man exactly like the prince, pretending that it was impossible to get one. But on the prince insisting upon the fulfillment of the condition, his brother was produced. The joy of the two brothers on meeting each other was great. The Rakshasi said to the princess, "Don't kill me, and I will tell you a secret which will save the life of the elder prince." She then told them that the mendicant was a worshipper of the goddess Kali, who had a temple not far off, that he belonged to that sect of Hindus who seek perfection from intercourse with the spirits of departed men, that he had already sacrificed at the altar of Kali 6 human victims whose skulls could be seen in niches inside her temple, that he could become perfect when the 7th victim was sacrificed, and that the elder prince was intended for the 7th victim. The Rakshasi then told the prince to go immediately to the temple to find out the truth of what she had said. To the temple they accordingly went. When the elder prince went inside the temple, the skulls in the niches laughed a ghastly laugh. Horror struck at the sight and sound, he inquired the cause of the laughter, and the skulls told him that they were glad because they were about to get another added to their number. One of the skulls, as spokesman of the rest, said, "Young prince, in a few days the mendicant's devotions will be completed, and you will be brought into this temple, and your head will be cut off, and you will keep company with us. But there is one way by which you can escape that fate and do us good." "Oh, do tell me," said the prince, "what that way is, and I promise to do you all the good I can." The skull replied, "When the mendicant brings you into this temple to offer you up as a sacrifice before cutting off your head, he will tell you to prostrate yourself before Mother Kali, and while you prostrate yourself, he will cut off your head. But take our advice. When he tells you to bow down before Kali, you tell him that as a prince you never bowed down to anyone, that you never knew what bowing down was, and that the mendicant should show it to you by himself doing it in your presence. And when he bows down to show you how it is done, you take up your sword and separate his head from his body. And when you do that, we shall all be restored to life, as the mendicant's vows will be unfulfilled." The elder prince thanked the skulls for their advice and went into the hut of the mendicant along with his younger brother. In the course of a few days, the mendicant's devotions were completed. On the following day, he told the prince to go along with him to the temple of Kali, for what reason he did not mention. But the prince knew it was to offer him up as a victim to the goddess. The younger prince also went with them, but he was not allowed to go inside the temple. The mendicant then stood in the presence of Kali and said to the prince, "Bow down to the goddess." The prince replied, "I have not, as a prince, bowed to anyone. I do not know how to perform the act of prostration. Please show me the way first, and I will gladly do it."
The mendicant then prostrated himself before the goddess, and while he was doing so, the prince at one stroke of his sword separated his head from his body. Immediately, the skulls in the niches of the temple laughed aloud, and the goddess herself became propitious to the prince and gave him that virtue of perfection which the mendicant had sought to obtain. The skulls were again united to their respective bodies and became living men, and the two princes returned to their country. So, my dear friends, here we are with a new story, and after completing this story, I must say, with the in the conclusion, what we came to know that goddess Kali, or in that sense, in any or we may say rather in any form, God always blesses us. Always bless us who does the right thing and who does good for everyone. See, the blessing of perfectness was bestowed on the elder princes, not to the mendicant, though he had done his sadhana, or in that sense we can say penance for years after years, but still he was not worthy enough to get the boon of perfectness. So moral of the story is, don't put your energy into a negative way. Let the energy flow into the path what nature wants to flow, so that good will come out of that energy. So with this notion, I must say, here my story ended. The Natiya throne withered. So in Bangla, Amar kothati furolo, note gasti murolo, kenore note muroli, goru keno ghash khay, kenore goru ghash khas, rakhal keno ghash day na, kenore goru kenore rakhal ghash deshna, বউ কেন ভাত দেয় না, কেন রে বউ ভাত দিস না, খোকা কেন কাঁদে, কেন রে খোকা কাঁদিস, পিঁপড়ে কেন কামড়ায়, কেন রে পিঁপড়ে কামড়াস, কুট কুট কুট. সো তারা